107.3 FM on sirenonline.co.uk. This is Siren FM.
Hello, everybody. Hello. Hello. I'm so excited to be here. It's taken many years of practice and dreams to arrive on Siren 103. I can't keep that up, mate.
That's just me.
I just thought that people would be thinking, Lord Adebowale, you know, he's on the radio, he's going to be posh, but or at least have a posher voice. But I'm afraid this is me. And they've done a fantastic job. Andrew and Ellie. Hello, Ellie. You know, you've got to say hello. And I've got my wife T in the audience, and I've got to stop looking at her because she makes me laugh when she's smiling at me and all that. But I've got the day off, and I've decided to do something I've always wanted to do, which is talk nonsense on the radio for a bit and have people saying, God, I wish he'd stick to his day job. But I know that I have, I've got to say hello to some people just for a second because they may or may not be listening. But my team at Turning Point and the team Turning Point, who've been just fantastic over the last, about 15 years actually. Nothing else. I thought I'd say hello to you. And I've got a record that I want to play you, which is kind of one of my favourites, but it's kind of about inspiration, and we've got this thing at TP about we're inspired by possibility, and this record's very, very inspiring. So hello to everybody at TP, hello to everybody in Lincolnshire, Siren 103 FM people. This is Lord VOA DJ, about to play you The Hole of the Moon by The Waterboys.
Okay, that's The Waterboys, The Hole of the Moon, and actually I got it wrong already. I was telling everybody about Siren 103. If you're listening to Siren 103 and you're probably wondering why you're hearing grass growing, it's because you should be listening to Siren 107, actually, which is the station I'm on. And it's all been live streamed, so if I wave, you can wave back and I won't be able to see you. So that's a really stupid thing. Mary Stewart, who's the Vice Chancellor of I've got to say hello to her. We don't know whether she's in Lincoln or London, but I think she's in Lincoln, because she kind of gave me access to the airwaves for the next, I don't know, couple of hours, actually. And it's kind of, I think she's a fantastic VC. She's kind of cool, isn't she? And we all think that she's very intelligent and superb, and she's a professor and all that, whereas I'm just a visiting something or other. But today, I'm a DJ, and this evening we will be sitting round a dinner at the major event of Lincolnshire, the great and the good. The Lincolnshire, there'll be wine bars around Lincolnshire empty. There'll be clubs where the pipes will not be smoked. Slippers will be left by the fire. The butlers will be left wondering what to do as the great families of Lincolnshire and me and T turn up at the cathedral for these din-dins to celebrate the Magna Carta. And I've got to be honest with you, history was not one of my major subjects. I do know that the Magna Carta has a lot of signatures on it. And if it wasn't for the Magna Carta, I wouldn't be sitting here. You could say that the Magna Carta actually ended slavery of a kind and the complete domination of the royalty, the introduction of what we might call democracy. And it happened here in Lincoln. No, it didn't, actually. It happened down south, didn't it? Runnymede. And the Runnymede Trust and all that. I know that. I was just joking with people here, actually. But we've got one of the copies. We've actually got one of the copies of the Magna Carta in the cathedral. And in fact, all three copies, I don't know where, there's one in London, one in Lincoln, one at the, there's one somewhere else.
There's one in Salisbury
Cathedral. They're all coming together.
The difference is the Salisbury Cathedral has a bit of the seal on it.
There you go.
But ours is unique because it has the Magna Carta and the Charter of the Forest.
There you go. We've got the Charter
Magna
and the
Carta
Forest.
For you guys. See, the Magna Carta. For you, the bosses.
There you go.
Charter of the Forest for us.
For country people who live in, they got a Charter of the Forest, which means they can walk in the forest without being shot by arrows. So we're all going to celebrate the Magna Carta, but this afternoon I've got some guests, which I'm really excited about. I mean, they're all professionals, and I'm an amateur, so I hope they're going to be kind of easy on me. And I couldn't have made my life any harder by my first guest, the interview I'm going to have with. The sort of, I don't know, she's a national treasure. I don't know whether that's an insult to call somebody national treasure or anything. Is it the same as saying you're old? But Angela Rippon is a national treasure. She's the coolest.
You could put
person.
It to her she's to see if she's.
I'm not going to say, are you a national treasure or are you old, Angela? That's not very nice. But she's cool, and she's going to come on, and I'm going to talk to Angela Rippon. And then I've got Baroness Helena Kennedy, who, there are some things about Baroness Helena Kennedy which may not be known by everyone, actually. which I'm going to ask her about. It's not going to be embarrassing, they're just going to be interesting. Things that I know that she has done, which are really interesting. And then, to finish off with, I have got the very definition of cool coming in. He is a man that you will have laughed at and seen on the TV and probably seen live. He's constantly touring. And he will be, right now in Lincolnshire, the only other guy with dreadlocks in the county. And one of my requests to Andy and Ellie when we were putting the show together was that I wanted to see somebody with dreadlocks in the studio. And they are so professional. I have referred to them as the SAS of Administrative Radio Production. Went out and found Reginald D Hunter to come in, and not to come in, he's going to phone in, and I'm going to have a chat with him, and we're going to talk about stuff, and I think he will try and be, well, he'll tell us about his new tour, but he'll also, we'll talk about what it's like to be bros. We'll do some male bonding live on air. And there's a question I want to ask him, actually, about something that black guys do when they see each other on the street, which is the nod. Now, if there are black guys listening, they will know what I mean. If you're not a black guy, then you'll be thinking, what is that about? But if you're watching live streaming, I will demonstrate the nod to you right now. It's like that. It's a kind of cool nod of the head. Yes, I'm doing it to Andrew. I'm doing it to, it's like that. It's an acknowledgement of a shared history, actually. It's something like that. Or if you are walking through Lincoln, it's acknowledgement that you're the only other one. But anyway, I shouldn't say that. No, there are some, it's not quite. Well, it's true, isn't it? Statistically speaking, I'm not saying anything out of the order. So I think it might be time for another song and another tune. People may not have heard this, but I just think it's got a lovely kind of swing to it. But the words, if you listen to them, are a little bit naughty. But it's in the afternoon. And it's all about growing old together and sort of getting to know each other and how things change. And it's by the Morning Benders, I think. But they found this tune that I didn't think they'd be able to find. It's a kind of a secret, a guilty secret of mine, this tune. But anyway, stand by your beds, turn the radio up and listen to the Morning Benders. Okay, so I am very honoured, deeply honoured, to be talking to, I think, I'm going to ask you a question in a minute, but first of all, I'm going to announce my next guest, and there's going to be a little round of applause, because I think she's ace. It's Angela Rippon, everyone. Angela Rippon. It's actually Professor Angela Rippon. Angela, are you there?
I am indeed.
Oh, thank God. For a second there, I thought you thought, you know what, I could be out shopping or something. You could be doing something else instead of listening
now,
to this
amateur. Come on, they tell
this
me
amateur.
It's always been your ambition to do this.
That's
so
true.
Enjoy
that
the
is,
moment.
That is true. That is true. But I must admit, I am a little nervous. Just
Why?
A little nervous. Well, because I've never done it before and you're a professional.
Oh yeah, but come on, it's
you're
only radio.
Cool.
And you know what radio is. There's a lovely old Jewish saying, which is from my lips to God's ear. And you should think about that with radio because, you know, there's only one person listening to you at the moment. And that's the one person who's on the other end of the radio. Cumulatively, there may be several thousand of them.
Ooh,
you're
no,
actually
don't
only
say
talk,
that.
You're, no, you're only talking to one person at a time. So just have a chat with them and now you can have a chat with me.
Well, I'm talking to you. That is a fantastic tip for my future career as chief executive of Turning Point. that is fantastic. I mean, thank you for coming on. I mean,
no,
you're
my
really
pleasure.
Are
you having fun this morning?
I am. I'm starting to a little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit. I'm a little bit nervous. But is it true? So I've just got to ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you like? Because we were talking earlier, and I said, you know, Angela Rippon, she's a national treasure, right? Is that okay? Is it okay to call you a national treasure? Or does it sound a bit sort of...
It's a little embarrassing to be on the receiving end of it, but...
No, but you are, though, aren't you? You're
well,
kind
thank
of,
you.
You know, people were talking about you as being the next presenter of Top Gear.
Oh, no. It was really interesting because I did present the original series when it was, first of all, in the region and then when it was networked.
Yeah.
And so, yes, I did do it.
And
but, you know,
good.
That was a very long time ago. And it was an entirely different sort of programme. It was a motoring programme being presented by me, a journalist. So we looked at kind of motoring things. But over the years, it's developed and evolved until, you know, right now, it's a kind
it's
of... It's an entertainment programme with cars. does, and it's quite different. And actually, I have to say, when all of this sort of started, I was the first one to say, no, there's no way I'm going to be the new presenter. It was, you know, other
but
people
I think
were speculating
I,
on it.
But I don't know. I don't know, Angela. Seriously, I think you've got it. You've got
well,
life in your voice. You know about cars.
Well.
You know,
well, I tell you what,
cool.
It would be, as I've said all along, when once they've got their team together, and whatever team they put together, I'm sure it'll be brilliant. But if they just ask the old girl occasionally to do the odd film for them, that would be fun. But I think that that's probably about
right,
as far
okay. Right,
okay.
So I want to start something now, right? You know, you have these web sort of things that you sign. I want to start a petition. As a licensed payer,
I want you back on.
I want you back on.
Well, I'm never off the telly as it is at the moment. Anyway,
well,
with all the other things.
No, I want you on Top Gear. That's the way it's got to be. You represent what it takes. Now,
don't be disappointed then.
No, I will be. I won't be disappointed because we're going to win. We're having you on. We're going to bring you to Lincoln, and your first show is going to have me driving a Porsche.
Oh right. Do you like Porsche?
In the start. No, I don't actually. But I just.
No, I was going to say no. Ferrari would be much nicer. Actually, having sat in both a Porsche and a Ferrari, I have to tell you, the Ferrari is rather more comfortable.
What's the most expensive car you've ever sat in?
Well, funnily enough, actually, probably not a car. I actually drove a huge articulated lorry. I drove it on a section of the M6 before it was actually officially opened. And because I didn't have an HGV licence, which you have to have normally to drive those things.
Call the cops.
I was allowed to drive on this stretch of the M6, I think it was, that was about to be opened by the Minister of Transport. And I can't imagine how much that was. It must have been a fortune.
It must have been scary.
Those things, they cost a pretty penny. I've driven Bentleys and Rolls Royces and I've driven a Ferrari.
Your favourite car?
Oh.
Because I like cars.
Tell you what was my favourite car. Yeah. I had a Triumph GT6.
Really?
Bright yellow. GT6. I mean, I've driven a lot of sports cars in my life. I had a couple of MGs. Had an MGB and an MGB GT, which I loved. But I had this Triumph GT6, and it was bright yellow, and it had a very long front bonnet on it, and it was a perfect ladies' car. I loved it. I'm very fond of the little car I've got at the moment, actually.
What is it?
London. It's a Mazda MX-6 convertible.
Very stylish.
It's only a two-seater, that's the trouble, so there's room for me and the handbag and not
that's
much
very,
else.
Very stylish. You have done such a lot in your career. I remember, I know everybody asks about this, but I can't not have a conversation with you about that moment on the Morecambe and Wise show when I think it transformed kind of the idea of news reading as something nothing to do with showbiz and entertainment.
Yeah.
Suddenly you became this person who was multi-talented, who could do stuff. And then there was all these newsreaders after you.
Yeah, that's right. In Nothing Like a Dame, which was brilliant.
Yeah.
I loved that. But I tell you what was interesting about that. The thing is, of course, that, you know, newsreaders, we're not automatons. Well, I'm not a newsreader anymore, but we're not automatons. And, you know, although the news is a serious business and is very often,
sadly,
full of death, doom and disaster,
yeah.
You know, all of us have got a life beyond the news desk. And I think the great thing about that was, let's first start, put the show into context, because an awful lot of the people listening to you right now, Victor, will be people who perhaps, you know, weren't even born when we were doing it. 1984. No, what was it? 1976, I think it was. 1976.
Everybody missed you, Duke, can remember well. I can tell you that. They're all going, yeah, I know, I remember.
But it was the programme that everybody watched, because there were four channels at the time. It was, you know, we had an audience of 23 million, which you just don't get these days.
Well, that's Sky nonsense.
And what they asked people to do at the end of their programme, their Christmas show, was to do something that was completely off the wall from what they were known for. So that's when Glenda Jackson, who was a very kind of very straight Shakespearean actress, did the famous bit, you know, with dressed up as...
That's not what she's famous for, but carry on.
No, but she was dressed up as... she was Cleopatra, wasn't
she?
That's right.
Yeah.
And you had Andre Previn, who was the conductor of the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, doing his bit, which I still think is the funniest thing of all. And so it was the programme, and they wanted people to do something that was quite different. And I studied classical ballet till I was 17. So they originally asked me to sing, and I said, not unless you want to clear the studio in 30 seconds flat. But I can dance, and that was why we did it.
Yeah,
and the great thing was, you see, it was an opportunity to show that outside of the death, doom and disaster, newsreaders have got a sense of humour and could do. And, of course, subsequently, whenever we have, at the end of the year, the newsreaders always do something for Pudsey, don't they?
Which
is fantastic. And I think it's great just to show that newsreaders can let their hair down and do something.
You
which
certainly did
not
that.
Before,
you
but then
that.
Go back to being the
Absolutely.
Professional newsreader.
Did people, because you're a trained journalist as well, and did people,
yeah,
after you
I, yeah.
did that, you went back to newsreading, did people look at you askance? Were you taken, you know, was it kind of, you know, Angela Rippon, the dancer and newsreader, or was it...
I think the general public just accept, you know, that just because you do one thing doesn't mean to say that there aren't other things that you can do.
Yeah.
And that, you know, if it's for the fun of it and for entertainment or to raise money or whatever, you know, for children in need, for instance, all of that, that actually it's fun to do it just to show another side of your character and for people
That's
to get to know
this.
The person behind the box. But as long as you go back when once you've done it to doing the thing that you do professionally,
yeah.
you know, I mean, I didn't turn up after that reading the news, you know, all glitzy like I was, you know, West End show dancer.
Some of the news you should have done. Election results anyway.
Because the news is a serious business, and you know, those occasions when you have to have someone reading the news who has presence and authority and credibility, you have to make, if that's what you do for a living, those are the qualities that you have to maintain.
But it's very rare to find both in both things, the sort of serious and the authority and the ability to have fun. You will not know this, you may not remember, but we actually met a while ago, years and years ago, when I was at Centrepoint. And I think you were doing a charity thing. And then I saw you a few months ago in the House of Lords.
Yes.
And I don't know what you were doing there. I thought you might have been trying on your seat. And I thought, well, she's coming in.
Oh,
which
I
would
don't
be perfectly appropriate.
No,
Why
I was
not?
There to see Rachel Hayhoe Flint, who's Baroness now, who's a friend of mine. And I came in just to see her about something, yes.
Although I've got a little story to tell you about that, which is deeply embarrassing.
Yeah.
I don't know much about cricket. And I actually thought she was a horse rider. This is absolutely true. And I walked up to her and I was telling her, I was saying, my wife would love to meet you. You know, that was a fantastic, you know, I think you, Pete, things that you do on a horse. And she was looking at me like, I just, yeah, I know. And I can't, from now on, Rachel, if you're out there, I'm so deeply, deeply embarrassed.
Well, you do know she's got a huge sense of humour.
I know.
Rachel.
Looks. I've got to be honest with you. She wasn't laughing. But I mean, I do. It was terribly embarrassing. Would you like to be in the House of Lords?
I think only if I felt that I could do something positive and worthwhile.
But
otherwise,
you could.
I don't see the point. You see?
You could, and you have.
Yeah.
I mean, you've written 14 books. 14 books. You're a visiting professor of the University of Lincoln. You have experienced the media. You were at the start of breakfast television. You've got a whole heap to offer.
Yeah. Well. The thing is, you see, I've been around in television for 48 and a half years.
Absolutely.
I'm looking towards my golden 50 years. I keep thinking that if the BBC will keep me employed for another 18 months, I shall have made the 50 years.
Come on, Beebe. Another 18 years.
Well, I don't know about that, darling. I should be a very, very old lady then. But I've got so much work on with the BBC at the moment. They keep asking me to do wonderful, exciting, and fun projects. And
so what are you working on
now? I should
be
around for another year.
What are you working on now?
Couple of things, actually. I do a programme that some of your listeners may have seen called Rip Off Britain, which is the BBC's consumer programme. We do 45 programmes a year for them. And I'm in the middle of filming a whole new series for them. And that's for daytime television. And one of the series that we did on food is about to go out on primetime as well. So that'll be coming up, I think, in July. I film for The One Show, which I do on a pretty regular basis. I make films for them on BBC One. And I'm about to start filming a really exciting new project that I'll be doing over the summer for BBC Science with the television doctor, Chris Van Tulleken. The pair of us are going to be making 2 one-hour specials for the BBC next year, which are going to be really fun and really exciting. So
and then there's Top
Gear. A lot
of
work coming up, actually, at the moment.
You know, you are busy. You might be too busy for the House of Lords, actually. But I think I think Baroness Rippon has got a certain... Dear. Doesn't it? Everybody's nodding. Yeah. They're all going, I can see you. On the crossbenches, you know, so you don't have to... You can slag all the parties off and you can be...
As you probably know, I mean, I am an ambassador for the Alzheimer's Society, and David Cameron, the Prime Minister, 3 years ago, asked me to co-chair one of his committees on dementia, which I've been doing for the last 3 years. And, you know, we're making huge strides there in creating dementia-friendly communities around the country, getting a greater understanding for dementia. So we're doing
You're a natural. You're
area.
A natural. I think you're being modest. I think you're being modest,
well,
Baroness
well,
Angela
Rippon.
Well,
I think we all do what we can.
You should be on there. I want to ask you, there's something, because listening to this, there might be, I don't know, one or two students of the media listening to this. And I know that you're a visiting professor here. And I'm just wondering, if you were starting now and you wanted to be, you know, Baroness Professor Angela Rippon, what advice would you give? Because when I go to the BBC, the thing that I do notice, is that there's a kind of, you have to be connected. So people who tend to get into the media tend to have connections in the media. It's just a terrible thing. It's just what I've noticed.
Not necessarily.
It's my experience.
No, I think that's a fairly sort of narrow... it isn't like that.
So what does it take then? What does it take if it doesn't take connections?
The thing is, of course, it's a very crowded profession now, and there are lots of... And all of those students up there in the media department of Lincoln will know this, that there are a lot of universities now with a lot of very hopeful young people who want to get into journalism stroke the media.
Yeah.
And I think... So, first of all, you have to have a passion. You really, really want to do it. Mm-hmm. You want to be a communicator. I think that's the most important thing. All of the skills one would have to take for as read, that you have the skills of being a writer, a listener, a good listener if you're going to do interviews, and you're able to research. And also, I think you have to come with something that's that little bit extra. Because, you know, if you want to... It depends, I suppose, on what part of journalism and broadcasting you want to be in. But in my area, in news and current affairs, for instance, just having your degree in media training or journalism or whatever is not enough. I think you've got to have something else. If you are able to go in a crowded profession and stand out from the crowd and actually inspire the people that are likely to employ you by saying, I can see that this person has real passion for this job, but secondly, they're going to bring something extra to it. You know, your knowledge of politics or history or geography or science or whatever. So, in other words, you have a specialist subject that you can offer. You have an expertise in something, which will make you stand out from the crowd. But also something in the way that you present. And I always think that the great thing about being a good presenter, whether it's in light entertainment, news, current affairs, whatever, but in if you like, factual programming, is that ability to connect with the audience and be a good communicator.
Right.
To be able to transmit to them the kind of passion and interest.
How am I doing? Because you're the pro. I don't mind. My ego's not involved in this. I've got to be honest. I've got a few gongs after my name, so I've sorted that out. So
go back to what we said at the beginning. Yeah. I think the great thing about radio is that it is a conversation between people, and it depends again on the kind of radio that you do. I mean, if this was a political program and you were talking to me about a specific subject like dementia or like, you know, what's happening to the Greek economy at the moment or whatever, it would be an entirely different kind of interview, and you would have different questions and I would have a different delivery.
Yeah.
But what we're doing is what a lot of radio stations do, which is they give people the opportunity on radio to talk to each other and have a conversation.
I reckon and that's I about a five
big,
then.
The big skill is being able to have a conversation with someone, listen to what they say, engage them, and just give your listeners at home something that
down.
They think
Three.
Afterwards. We were part of that conversation.
Angela, I think you've been absolutely fantastic. I'm going to play a record for you, actually.
I
do hope you like Stevie Wonder.
Yes, I do.
I do hope you like Stevie Wonder, because
I saw him in concert last year, actually,
in
the south of France. He was brilliant.
You lucky, honestly. Just not only are you a national treasure, but you've seen Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
I wish to kiss the hem of your gown. I think that's amazing. so we are going to play for Angela Rippon, Professor Angela Rippon, who I'm going to say goodbye to now and thank her again for being
so generous. Look, you enjoy the rest of your day there. You have
fun. We're going to play this for you. This is Stevie Wonder. Higher Ground. Okay, so my next guest is, she's just an amazing person. She has great stamina, actually, apart from anything else, because she's just done so much. And the reason why I say she's got great stamina is that being a human rights lawyer or being someone concerned with the rights of others in this day and age requires huge intellectual strength and huge stamina. And I've always been fascinated by how she actually brings that to the fore and she the sheer kind of guts that she has. But anyway, it's going to be Baroness Helena Kennedy, one of our most distinguished lawyers, spent a professional life giving voice to those who basically haven't got a lot of power. So we're going to talk to Baroness Helena Kennedy. Before we do that, the next record is going to come on and you're going to go, what? And that's because it's not in English. It's actually in Yoruba. And it's by the Peacock Guitar Band. And in the 70s, Nigeria was a really cool place. There was lots going on. There was lots of oil money. There still is, but it's in the hands of fewer people. And it was quite a fashionable thing. And I found this album that had lots of sort of 1970s Nigerian funk on it. And just to make Andrew's life really easy, when he asked me for a track list, I thought, you know what? I won't mind playing on over the airwaves of Lincolnshire and a song sung in Yoruba. If he can find it, then he will be a hero. And you know what? He found it, so we're going to play it. And it is Eddie Quenter, the Peacock Guitar Band. Wasn't that lovely? I mean, if you like jollof rice and jerk chicken, and you know, yeah, then that's for you. You might be eating it now. And in fact, I do know that there may well be some people at Turning Point and in Lincoln and Lincolnshire, and there'll be certainly people in Lagos who'll be sitting down listening to this, thinking, you know what, that's weird. I was just about to have some jollof rice, and this guy who says he's a lord in... I will tell you this, actually. This is true. So if I go on TV, which isn't very often, but if I go on TV and I'm interviewed and I've got my dreads out, I get emails from Nigerians in Nigeria, and the first thing they write is, "You are a lord!" Really? With hair like the kind, it's like, what? Are you really in the House of Lords with dreadlocks? I say, yeah, I am. You know what? It's just hair. You know, it's just hair. But it's a kind of symbol. If you, it's a symbol of sort of, you're with the people. I'm not. It's just hair. When I get in my Bentley, I'm joking. I don't have a Bentley. So, have we got Baroness Helena Kennedy?
We do.
Hello.
We do. And Victor, you are with the people.
I am with
the people. The people certainly think that you're with them.
Oh, that's good.
And,
I think
and
down.
As one of the people, I feel you're very much one of us.
You have not
become one of the political elites that has left us all behind.
Oh, that's so... what a fantastic place to start a chat. I am definitely one of the... Because you know something about the House of Lords, it does separate you, doesn't it? When you go through those gates.
Yes.
It's strange, isn't it?
And everybody else has searched uphill and down dale, but we sail through because we are beyond question.
It is weird, isn't it? And you go in, and there's a moat between you and the public, and you go in, and you can't hear, see, or smell them. And then there's somebody who says, "Milud."
Yeah.
And I find that really... How do you find it?
Well, milady. I mean, you know, I remember somebody saying to my mother, "Mrs. Kennedy, how do you feel about your daughter being a lady?" And my mother said, "But all my daughters are ladies."
Absolutely. All my daughters.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think people take it seriously these days, the House of Lords?
Well, I mean, I think...
Really?
No, I think there's still a little bit of thinking that you must be a grandee.
Mm.
And then, you know, when you come across as being a sort of real person, then they're kind of rather pleasantly surprised.
I know. I tried to get the people, the people who work in the House, to not call me Milud.
No, they wouldn't like that.
And do you know what they said to me? This guy said to me, he said, "Well, the problem with that, Milud, is that we'd have to remember the names of everybody, and there's a lot of you, so
yeah,
we're not going to bother, Milud."
Yeah, that's right. And we'd also have to remember the ones who insist on being Milud, as distinct from the ones who are not so bothered. So.
No, there are people who insist on it.
Oh, I think so.
Somebody once referred to me as not a proper peer, which I think is interesting. It's like snobbery in snobbery. you know, snobbery in the House of Lords. That makes
because
me laugh.
Because we were appointed and we didn't get there because our daddies were.
That's true. You know, that's true.
So aristocratic landowners.
Well, no, but there's still time. What are you up to these days, Helena?
Well, I'm the head of an Oxford college, Mansfield College at Oxford University. Ooh. I'm still doing cases, difficult human rights cases. Yeah. And, of course, like you, people imagine we just swan into the House of Lords, but yeah. I actually, you know, I sat on the Joint Committee of Human Rights for, you know, the last 3 years, and I'm going to take over on the Justice Committee of the European Union, select committee, you know, the justice element of it. So I do quite a lot in the House of Lords, and as you know, we're always having battles about bad things that governments want to do to law. Governments of all complexions seem to always want to reduce people's rights, and so we have to fight those battles.
Mm. Tell me about the human rights, because the Human Rights Act and the Bill of Rights, I kind of, especially today, because this evening I'm going to this din-din, and it's all going to be about the Magna Carta, and everybody knows that there's going to be a huge row about the Human Rights Bill and the Bill of Rights. And I think most people are a bit kind of confused about what it is and what's likely to happen. That's why I wanted you on the program. It's like, so what is it that people should know?
Well, first of all, let me tell you that I'm someone who believes very firmly in bills of rights and in people knowing what their rights are. I remember as a young lawyer going out to the United States when I was in my late 20s, and I got to know a particularly wonderful man who was a great American constitutional lawyer, who, you know, was a rights lawyer. Mm. And he said, you know, people are taught in schools in America, you know, these are my rights. And although, you know, it doesn't, you know, the rights are abused there too, as we know, and particularly for the black community. But people learn at an early stage of their lives that they do have rights, and that they're like they can say to, you know, a policeman who stops them, "Why are you doing that?" You know, you have to have reasons and so forth. And knowing that you have rights, in fact, is very empowering to people. And so I've been a believer. Now, let me just explain that. I chaired a big campaign to have a British Bill of Rights back in the 90s, along with other changes to Parliament and so on.
Yeah.
And it was decided that, in fact, a simpler thing, rather than fight over which rights should be in there and which rights shouldn't, we should actually embrace the rights that were in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and which were then written into the European Convention or written up as the European Convention by British lawyers. And that's one of the things that people don't know, is that it was British lawyers who wrote the European Convention on Human Rights. And the idea was not just that we would have rights, but that actually people in all over Europe, indeed all around the world, should have rights based on the fact that they're human beings. Mm. And it's not because, you know, of your class or because of your colour or because of your gender or whatever. It had to be vested in you because you're a human being. And so, you don't say, well, of course, you know, we take away your right to have a family and so on, or we don't recognise it as being important.
But did something go wrong then? Because every time I hear about the human rights, what you hear is some nasty person we can't get rid of or keep in prison or do something because of his human rights.
Yeah.
And that's how it's put across. And I just wonder, did something go wrong in the debate or the dialogue about rights that's meant that it's okay?
What we've got to remember
to have this sort of debate in which human rights are seen as a bad thing or something that gets in the way of justice in some strange land.
What we've got to remember is that actually it wasn't the Human Rights Act that made people feel angry towards terrorists or towards prisoners or towards illegal immigrants or whatever. Those things have existed in societies and existed before we ever had the Human Rights Act.
Mm.
What the Human Rights Act, of course, has done is it's given argument to people to say, look, I'm a human being, and although I might be an illegal immigrant, I shouldn't just be thrown into a cell and deported without there being due process and proper legal proceedings, because I may be an asylum seeker. Mm. I may actually be someone fleeing from ISIS. And having come in one of those boats that were sinking in the Mediterranean, you think they're all, you know, there's people who have written in the tabloid press about them being cockroaches and used disgusting language.
Oh, there's been some shocking things said.
And while some of them are people who are just fleeing because they're impoverished and they want a better life, but many others are actually fleeing because they have no life where they where they've come from.
Yeah.
They actually will be killed if they stay there. And so we, you know, we've got to have distinctions, and law has to play its part in deciding whose rights should be recognised.
What's wrong with the Bill of Rights, though? Because we could have that in a Bill of Rights. We could reboot the idea of human rights. But we could actually sort of, what's the rebrand is the word that people use, rebrand it by calling it a Bill of Rights. Put all those things in a British Bill of Rights, and Bob's your uncle. We see it's popular again. So why should we? Why bother having any debate about the getting out of the European human rights and just focus on having a UK Bill of Rights that incorporates the things that you just talked about? I mean, what's wrong with that?
That can sound really appealing, except that there will be some people who will never be satisfied in giving rights to people they don't like. And that will be because of the colour of their skin, or because they're immigrants, or because they're somebody who's committed an offence, and people are flawed, and people do that. And the proper process is to put them on trial, and if they're guilty, to send them to prison or punish them appropriately. But you don't start treating them as if they're not human. Mm. And so what one's saying here is that there's nothing wrong with in principle with the idea of a British Bill of Rights, but there is if it means less rights for certain people. And what many of the people who are advocating a British Bill of Rights are wanting is that you and me, or, you know, they might even hesitate a wee bit about you. And
they'll definitely hesitate a wee bit about me. Yeah. There's quite a lot hesitating about me now, to be honest.
And they might hesitate a wee bit about me, because I'm a woman who's a bolshy woman.
Yeah, you sound Scottish as well. That's trouble.
Yes, absolutely, especially at the moment when we don't like the Scots, in fact, you know.
Tricky.
So you start getting people wanting people like themselves to have rights, people who are less like themselves to have fewer rights, and then people that they really don't, you know, like very much at all to have no rights whatsoever.
Mm.
And so it's that business of having hierarchies of rights, because that was what allowed the Nazis in Germany to say, well, you know, the Jews are not like us, and communists are not like us, and so on, and to send them off to concentration camps. And in fact, judges and lawyers colluded in it.
Yeah, they did. You know, they did. I've got to ask you something, right? Moving off this subject, which is fascinating. I mean, I could talk with you about this all day, and you would need me to talk about it more. I read something about you which was fascinating, actually. I didn't realise you'd done this. Did you not host a late-night TV show at one point on Channel 4,
a discussion programme? It's called After Dark.
Tell us what happened. Tell us about After Dark.
After Dark was a fabulous thing. I mean, funnily enough, I was talking about it with some television people.
Yeah.
It became an iconic programme because it was when television wasn't on all through the night.
No.
And so when it closed down, you know, it usually was about, you know, 1 o'clock in the morning. But After Dark was allowed to just stay on
for as long as
the discussion was lively.
Yeah.
And so what happened was that some people watched all the way through, but some people would just been out for a night, they'd been to visit
a friend.
And they come in and they turn on the telly and they come in halfway through a conversation and then they become riveted and stay with it. And the conversations were always about very hot topics, you know, difficult topics. Sometimes it would be about, you know, child sexual abuse, or should we be going to war? And if so, you know, because I remember the first Gulf War, we had discussions about.
There was some good stuff. Didn't you have Oliver Reed on there?
Well, let me just tell you about Oliver Reed. I mean, most of the discussions were pretty just fascinating and interesting, and interesting groups of people to talk. And it was usually about, you know, six or seven people, bought a few bottles of wine, so people got kind of garrulous. But the awful thing that happened was that Oliver Reed came and he was already drunk when he arrived in the studio.
Yeah.
And we were having a discussion about.
He did like a beer, didn't he?
He did indeed. And he also he arrived and the discussion was about, you know, is it a masculine thing to want to go to war? Do women really would resist the idea of war? Is there something in the gender thing here?
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that is actually true, but that was the nature of the discussion. And there was a woman called Kate Millett, who's a very famous feminist in America, who's a gay woman, and she has been very much a leading light in women's liberation, certainly back in the 60s and 70s. And she was there, and she was saying that, you know, that war is actually, you know, counter to the human spirit, and it's destructive, and it's masculinity at its worst, right? That's what she was saying.
This got
right up his nose.
Mm.
And at one stage, he got terribly drunk, went off out of the studio, and I thought he'd gone to the loo, and I thought somebody would sort of persuade him to go home. But no, he came back in, and he climbed over the back of the sofa, took Kate Millett's face in his hands, and then produced to snog her in a in a very intimate way, and I'm sure that, that listeners will know what I mean. And she, the poor woman got the shock of her life.
I feel mortified now just hearing it.
Yeah, I mean, it was unbelievable. And so then I, of course, had to say to him, in a very Miss Jean Brodie Scottish
voice. Yeah, yeah, calling the police.
I said, Oliver, that is absolutely unacceptable. Yeah. And then I turned to everyone and I said, do people agree with me that that behaviour was absolutely unacceptable? Yes, miss, we think the behaviour was unacceptable. And then I said to him, I think you have to go, Oliver. Yeah. And then he was like a little boy and he said, oh, I was only having a bit of fun. And he wandered off into the night, drunk as he was, and didn't come back.
I think there was something of a little boy about him, actually.
Yeah.
There was something lost about the man.
And I think that he was a much more vulnerable person than people think. And,
and that was it's a real shame, actually, in a way. Yeah. He went, his light went out. But would you, did that put you off television a bit? Did you
it was fun, and lots of people, you know, at the time wrote in. Now it's one of those things where when they show worst moments in television, it comes. And then I do blush.
let it not be your... Actually, I've got one more thing to ask you about, actually, which is about Oxford and the whole thing about who gets in and who doesn't. And what's your take? Yeah, because there's all thing about, you know, the how do people get into Oxford?
Did I get into Oxford to be the head of a college? And I didn't go to Oxford, let me assure you.
No, you didn't, and as you know, came from
a big working class background, and I did not have any of that posh education.
Yeah.
But my college is very interesting. 80% of my students have come from state schools. And so, unlike anywhere in Oxford or Cambridge, 80%, and that has been the continuing thing for a couple of decades. And it's because the people who teach here really work hard at going out to schools and making connections with schools around the country to get people to apply and to get people to think about it early enough on. Because one of the things is that people sometimes choose the wrong subjects, and there are certain subjects that just, you know, don't work for Oxford. And so you have to know that stuff, and teachers in schools, when they're teaching, you know, kids who might benefit from Oxford.
If you don't know, you don't know.
Let me assure you, I do not believe that Oxford is the be-all and end-all.
No, Lincoln,
you
know, Lincoln
right
is.
For, you can have fabulous education, as you and
about.
I did, and we went to other places. But but for the right person, it can, and of course, for the rest of your life, it opens doors. We can't pretend that it doesn't.
You tell me about it. I've noticed the House of Lords is riddled. I kind of think there's a bit of a choice. There's one thing I've got to say to people before they go: if you're struggling with that choice between Mansfield and Lincoln, struggle on.
All I would say is
struggle on.
Choose a place that's going to feel right for you.
I agree.
And where you're going to feel comfortable, and where you're going to be authentically you.
Yeah.
And still be determined that you're going to be, you know, pursue the things that you love.
So choose Lincoln.
And that's what I mean. So you might well choose Lincoln, although there is a Lincoln College, Oxford.
There is. Helena, you've been fantastic and so generous with your time. I'm going to play a record in your honour.
Oh, lovely. But can I just tell you,
go on.
Lincoln's a great university.
It is.
I've come up, I've talked there and so on.
You're an honorary doc.
And I am, and I feel part
of
that
very
of
proud
your community.
We're very proud to have you as an honorary
doc. I'm proud to be part of it.
And I'm very pleased that you're in the house, because you make the place a bit more human, to be honest.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time, and we're going to play something important after listening to Baroness Helena Kennedy, which is on, if you listen to the words, it's kind of, it's something is important, but it's not always what we think is. So, Jukes, something important. That's Jukes with something important, and you got the drift. It's kind of, wasting time isn't always wasting time, I guess. It's what life's about sometimes. My next guest is a really, really incredible man. I mean, literally, I'm looking at his life and what he's done, and it's deeply impressive. I mean, the man must have some sort of inner confidence, which we'll no doubt talk about when he's ready to come on. But I've got another. I can't believe how well this show has gone so far. What do you reckon? I'm looking at my audience here. And
I'll have you back.
You'll have me back.
I'd
come back, actually, because I'm really enjoying this.
The looks from everybody who's going past are going, that's Lord Victor in there. What's he doing on the radio? Well, it is. Essentially, it is your radio station, sir.
Well, your worship. Your Worship. There's people. The only reason, the only time that people will actually use my title is if they want to sell me something. It's like, you know, Lord Adebowale.
Well, you actually
do you
told
want to buy,
me.
You want to buy this?
Let me embarrass you because you've been embarrassing everybody else.
Oh, no, have
I? A couple of months ago, when you and I were talking about this program, I kept saying Lord Victor, Lord. He said, "Stop calling me Lord Victor."
Stop it! It's just
it's
awful.
A bit like the ones in the House of Lords. They can't.
That's they have to do it. They have to call me. I should tell you my first day in the House. I tell people this story all the time. They don't believe it. The very first day I arrived at the House of Lords, and I walked through security, and I had my pass, and I walked into there's lots of bars in the Palace of Westminster. There's 14 bars, actually, in the Palace of Westminster. 7 miles of corridors in the House of Lords, right?
That number again. How many bars?
There are 14. Apparently there are 14. I mean, somebody's going to ring up and say, no, they're not. There are 17, but there are 14 bars in the Palace of Westminster. 7 miles of corridors in the House of Lords. I always start every speech whenever I've got people coming into the House of Lords. So T, who's sitting there, my wife, will know this. It's kind of boring, really, because I always say to them, please stay in this room, because I worry about you getting lost. But in the House of Lords, it is possible to get lost, but it is not possible to go thirsty, because you can imbibe your way around the Palace of Westminster. There'll be people outraged, won't there? Right, this is terrible. They should close at least 13 of those bars, and there'd be a terrible crowd rush for the champagne in the one bar. But there are bars in the Palace of Westminster. And why shouldn't there be? You know, there's a lot of work. It's thirsty work. You know, all that legislation, and people have got to. My audience are laughing. My cool people are. But it is one of those things. And the House of Lords is going to be very busy over the next 5 years, actually, because there's an awful lot of legislation. And I was at the Queen's Speech. We've only been to the Queen's Speech. I've only been to the Queen's Speech twice, right? The first time, it was... Well, I kind of say this to people, but it's partly true, actually. It was to prove to T that I actually was a member of the House of Lords. You know, so we just got married, and it was a case that, well, if we turn up, then there's absolutely, because you can't just walk in there off the street, particularly on the state opening. So if somebody tells you that they're a member of the House of Lords, ask them whether you can attend the state opening with them. Because on that day, if they're not a member of the House of Lords and they try and get in, they'll probably be shot. So you have to, hire. So the ermine thing, people don't know this. People actually think that when you go into the House of Lords, as I walk in, somebody says, good morning or good afternoon, my lord. And then I'm handed this ermine, and then you go in there. It's not like that. You don't wear ermine unless it's the state opening or unless you're weird. And there are some people who have actually bought their ermine. Guess how much the ermine, guess how much it costs for the, just have a guess.
Your microphone's open, you can have a guess.
Ellie.
£40.
£40. Yeah. £40 for the gown.
Well, I don't think it's real. I mean, they couldn't have
real
dead ermine.
It's real. No, some of them, you can choose. You don't have to have real ermine. You can have false ermine. I always go for the real stuff. No, I'm joking. The real fur. No, you can have real fur. 10,000.
For the whole kit.
You've just, I was going to drag that out for
you. You spoiled it for him.
It's gone up. It was, I'm told there's at least two members of the House of Lords who I shall not embarrass by naming them, who've actually bought their ermine, right?
Oh my goodness.
That one of them has it on a thing on his bedroom, which I think is just weird. It did cost about 7,000. I'm told it's about 10 grand. Mm-hmm. But the reason why I've only been twice is because guess how much it costs to hire one of those gowns for an hour. Come
7,
on.
7,000.
7,000?
No, I think...
7,500, actually.
500 a day.
Now, well, it would be roughly about... It would be about 500 quid. Yeah. How do you know?
Well, actually, Baroness Kennedy's not the only Baroness I happen to
know.
There is another Baroness I know. Jeez. Slightly connected with the university. Her sister used to be. Anyway, I can't say anymore because I have to do what you said you have to do.
It's 150 quid it cost. You have to sit there.
You dropped in a little line
on,
that, you know, you could take your wife along.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And because
you're
a lord, and Helena said this, I don't know whether it was right, that you're not searched when you go in.
No. Well, I've been searched before. You believe me, they've searched and searched and searched before I ever became a peer. So I've been searched thoroughly. And I guess, you know, you, the trust that you're not going to carry in, you know, sort of, I don't know, live mink or something.
Because there's all that thing about the sword length, isn't there?
Is
the,
there?
The, isn't there the
You
the
know
gap?
More about it than I do.
Well, then, yeah, I love it, darling. I'm waiting to get there. Myself.
You'll have to come down.
But the distance between the benches at the front is over a sword
That's
length.
True.
So,
it's
you,
so
can't
you can't, yeah, so you can't, it's, you can't thrust at the opposition. The opposition can thrust at you, and often do. But the cross benches can't thrust at anybody. We're in the middle. Oh, we literally sit across the benches.
Should we have an update? Update.
And where are we going?
It was all going so well in the first hour. Angela and Baroness Helena were there.
Have I made
your man,
a promise I cannot
Your man
keep.
Is so busy, he's desperate to get off the phone with somebody else.
All right, okay.
But he's on the phone with somebody else.
Fair
so
enough.
We have a team of several chasing him.
He's
only got 45 minutes, and then you and I have to go off and have a lie down in the corner.
I know. The man's got to make a living, hasn't he?
Should we have another one of your cracking tunes?
Well, yes, we can, actually.
Or do you want to say something else?
No, I was just going to say. I was just going to say about the House of Lords. Which is the thing about my wife's going? The coronet.
Your wife was waving at you, then.
Right? My wife has got. I've got to tell you this, right? So the first day we go into the house, this is just the first state opening, and there's people wearing diamonds at sort of half past 9 in the morning, you know, and they've got these coronets on, and my wife has sat next to a member of the House of Lords' wife. And she's got this coronet, and it is sparkling, like it turns your glasses dark, you know. And they got into conversation, and my wife said to her, "Well, where'd you get that from, you know?" And this lady of the coronet said, "Well, of course you just go down to Boodle's and ask." And we've had an ongoing joke now for nearly 10 years, haven't we? Where I pretend to be the person behind the counter at Boodle's, when my wife T walks in, and it goes something like. Knock, knock, knock. My wife walks. Can I have a coronet, please? I'll have that one over there, that 20,000 one. And the chap goes, "What's your name again?" And Tracy goes, "My name is Lady Adebowale." And the chap behind the counter goes, "Lady I'm calling the police." Anyway, time for another record, which is one of my favourites, actually. It's kind of, it's a bit of a dance thing, I guess. But I just think, actually, the video, which you can't see because it's on the radio, is really cool. There's something really empowering about it. There's something really woman about it, if you see what I mean. And it's by Kellis, and it's a cappella. Well, I'm so pleased. I'm absolutely bowled over about my next guest, who is on the phone right now. It's Reginald D Hunter. How are you, Reginald?
Hey there, brother. How you doing?
Oh, I'm doing fine. That's the best opening, and it's done with such cool. It's the accent. How you doing, brother? I mean, that's just it doesn't get much better, does it? Really. We were joking earlier because it's just so rare, isn't it? We've got two black guys. You still got the dreads? Are you still got dreads? Like, we've got two black guys with dreads talking to each other over the radio. I just think that's so rare. And I can't believe I'm making you laugh. That is just superb. Thank you very much.
Man, good thing I was about to cut my dreads off just before you called.
Don't do it. Don't do it. It's the thing. Now, I've got this. You're going to be on tour, aren't you, soon? Is that right?
Oh, I've been on tour for about 4 weeks.
You never stop. You're always
on
tour.
Yeah, I'm like the British football season.
No, that never stops too. But one of the things that I know about you, or at least I've read about you, which I just think is one of the coolest things I've ever heard, which is that your career, I've never known a career start as a dare. And I read that you started your comedy career as a dare. Somebody bet that you could... Is that true?
Yes, it was kind of a slash dare, slash bet. And I was drunk in a pub, and I was pissy about having been sacked from this pantomime, and I was pissy. I'm sorry, I'm supposed to say that. I was miffed.
Miffed. Yeah. This is Lincoln. This is Lincolnshire.
Excuse me. Yes, I was miffed that I had been sacked, and I was miffed with my then current girlfriend. So I was alcoholing and I was venting, but I was venting humorously. And then there was about 8 people in the pub, and they were being very tickled.
Yeah, they thought it was funny.
They were quite tickled, and so they that's when this guy sitting next to me at the bar passed along. You know, hey, man, you just got a comedy thing here every night. I bet you won't do it. Go ahead. I dare you. And I was like, ah.
And you were 27 at that time. Is that right?
27, 28.
I just think that's the coolest thing I've ever heard. Because as a result of that, you thought, I like this.
Yeah, I went on stage and the next week, and I called a man that ran the gig, and I said, hey, I want to be on your show. And he said, you a stand-up comedian? I said, nope. He said, you ever done it before? I said, nope. And he said, oh. He said, phew. He said, are you American? I said, yeah. Does that help?
And does it help? Because I think there's something, when I watch you on television and you're on those panel shows and your accent, there's something sort of glamorous about it, but it's kind of laid back. It stands out. It's such a big... Does it help being an American stand-up black comedian with dreadlocks in this country? Does it help?
Or does it... it can do, but, you know, it's like anything that's different or unusual. I mean, British people are naturally interested and fascinated. I mean, otherwise, y'all wouldn't make so many documentaries in other parts of the world with people going around going, wow, what's that? And why is that so different? And so, but I tell you what, man, being big, black, having this voice, it buys you about 5 minutes on stage. For 5 minutes, they'll be like, it's so unusual.
Yeah.
But after about 5 minutes, you better have some jokes.
You gotta make them laugh. I've got to be honest. I've been told that you being on this show is incredibly popular. And people, I've been told that people thought you were coming in. You were actually coming into the studio. Right? So you've got to come to Lincoln University. Right.
I got what?
You've got to come into Lincoln University. We got to give you an honorary something. Would you? Because actually, what people don't know, and they should know, is that you trained at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts.
Yeah.
You know, you are. You went to RADA.
You know, as you were saying that, what I swear to God, I thought you was about to say, what a lot of people don't know about you is that really you're stupid. That's what's fascinating. A lot of people don't realize just how dumb you are. Yes, that's true. I'm ethically ignorant in certain areas.
No, we've got to get you in. I want to be because I do the graduation ceremonies. Well, I don't do all of them, but I do some of them. And I just think that if we had, we need to set that up. We need to look at your. I think you've got to do something. I think you've done enough in life, basically, to warrant an honorary. I'm just going to start the campaign now. I think you should be Dr. D. Hunter.
If you guys give me an honorary degree, yeah. I'm going to jump on a plane, go home, and get in front of my family and go, see? I know it's 20 years late, but I told you I would.
Right, it's coming. We're going to sort that. I've got to ask, right, because my mum, who's a wonderful woman, but she still thinks I'm unemployed because I'm not a doctor. And I'm just thinking, do you get that? Did you have the same sort of... You know, you got to go and get yourself a proper job, like a lawyer or a doctor or something.
And I had that for a little while until I started paying their rent. Then they shut up.
Sorry.
That funny, is, that's funny how that works.
Yeah. There's a certain kind of American humor which I just find so, it's kind of direct, which is an example. So do you go back to Mississippi? Because I think of Mississippi and I think, I'm not sure that I'd want to be a black guy with dreads. I mean, that's a terrible thing to say, but it just... When you go back to Mississippi...
Not as terrible as the reality that made it necessary for you to say that.
Yeah.
Yes. And I'm from Georgia.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
I lived in Mississippi, and I mean, I tell you, man, it's amazing. Like, everybody has a country where if you go to it, you are exotic and beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, and like there's several places in the world where I turn up with dreadlocks. Yeah. You know, people are like, hey, man, what's happening?
Where are they? Where are those places? I need to... I need a holiday.
Britain. I would say Britain is pretty good for that.
Yeah, it's true.
I would say uh, I'd say parts of Germany. We'll really be thrilled to see you.
Yeah.
And but places, and even in certain parts of Africa, they'd be happy to see you.
Yeah.
Now, they might grab you and remove your dreadlocks. They're so happy to see you. But still, though, they still happy, though. They're like, hey, this dude done brought me some dreadlocks. I can sell these.
But in Mississippi? I mean, how is that? I mean, when you, Georgia,
I mean,
when
you... It's amazing. In the South, and not just Mississippi, but in the South, I can say, and in certain other parts of the United States, dreadlocks signify rappers, drug dealers, and so like, the police on me, you know, just like, over here, my hair, my dreadlocks sort of reminds people of the Afro-Caribbean, maybe reggae.
Yeah.
But in the other part, in much of America, I'm a threat.
Yeah.
I'm a big Negro with dreadlocks. Keep your eye on him.
Welcome to the club.
We may have to get him face down any minute.
I have this image in my mind as you were telling us about the two of us walking down the street in Mississippi. It'd be like twin threats, wouldn't it? It's a strange idea that, you know, we're not what people think we are. It's quite a shock.
Well, you know what, man? I mean, racism doesn't trouble me the way it seems to trouble other people. I don't think racism is really the problem. There's lots of people who are racist. Black people can be racist, but I got some Pakistani friends, and they some of the most racist people going. Everybody got racism going.
True.
But the problem is white supremacy. And white supremacy, there's some white people that white supremacists don't like. I mean,
that's true, actually. That is true. So you think we've got it easy over here? You think we've got it easy, sort of black people?
Black people?
Yeah, because we talk about racism, not white supremacy. So we've got them over here. And if you're listening, good afternoon.
I think black people got it over here easier, and I think white people in general have it easier over here. Because
really?
if somebody kills you over here, it's not likely they shot you.
Yeah,
everything else, I can outrun.
Yeah. You can't. I mean, that is true. That is true. It's guns, isn't it? I mean, I've been to America a couple of times, and it does make me nervous. I can't deny it. You know, you get off that, you walk down the street, and there's a policeman. I mean, policemen in London have guns, but it's kind of, you read this stuff and you think, ooh, you know, if I say the wrong thing, it could be my last thing, you know? But you seem perfectly relaxed. You still live over there. You're still chilled. You still live over there. You don't live here, do you, generally? So you must have some sort of mechanism, some sort of protection.
I live on the road, man. You know what they say, move and target, baby, move and target.
You just keep moving, and that's how it's done.
Yeah? I mean, my dad gave me a motto. If you're going to get shot, make sure they shoot you in your ass.
Oh, God.
Don't be standing right there just looking at them.
That is terrible. So, I want you to think about the advice that you would give, right? So, there's lots of young black guys growing up in this country, and...
Oh, yes. I know exactly what I tell them.
You know, they want to be like
your ass. No.
That's a good place to start, but that's unlikely. That's unlikely. So there's black guys that have been listening to this now, and they've got Reginald D Hunter, who actually is a highly, highly intelligent man who, you know, who also is... What are you going to tell them? What are you going to say? What are you going to say to the students here listening, thinking, you know what? He's the coolest guy.
And I'm talking to black young men, or who am I addressing when I say this wonderful thing I'm about to say?
Well, I think you're addressing young people, actually. Black
and
white.
Young people.
Yeah, just young people.
Oh, I would say this. Seek to be intellectuals. And by intellectuals, I don't mean erudite in a subject or stuffy. The true intellectuals, no matter if they're overeducated or if they can barely read, true intellectuals are people who are always interested.
You see, I just think that is... Do you know what? I'm going to ask you something else. I know we're going to get you in to do this. We're going to give you an honorary doc. I can do that because I'm Chancellor. Right? I'm gonna we're going to do that. People in the studio are going, no, you can't. But you can. We're going to give you. But there's one thing.
I tell you what. I actually would settle. So if you just got some A4 paper, you just got an ink pen, and you just wrote me a degree, and then you just let me walk on stage, and you hand me that piece of paper, that'd just be between me and you. That'd be good enough for me, man.
You gotta do it in front of a crowd of hundreds, and I'm gonna ask you to come and do a little masterclass here, because I think that what you just said about being an intellectual is exactly that's my thing, and it is so true. I'm making a formal invite, right? We can send it out to you in vellum, right? It will be delivered on horseback from the Chancellor of the University of Lincoln, and it'll be an invite to come and receive an honorary something, and then we're gonna ask you to do a masterclass. Would you do that for us?
Lord brother, I accept thy invitation.
And just keep calling me Lord brother. That will just—that's gonna do me, and that's so. From now on, everybody in Lincoln, I'm Lord Brother, okay? Reginald, you have been so generous with your time. I know how busy you are. I'm gonna find a chance to come and see you live. I think you are just an ace person.
If you manage to come see this show, my next show, come backstage and we'll go somewhere and knock the frost off a couple.
You are on. You are so on, Dr. Brother. You're so on. My wife T is sitting in the studio. She's going, and me. So yeah, we going out.
Well then, there it is.
That's it. Job done. Reginald, I'm gonna play a record in your honour.
Okay.
And oddly enough, because we've been talking about the world and all that, it's gonna be called a record called Leaders of the World, Leaders of the Free World actually, by Elbow. Have you heard of Elbow? You've come across Elbow before. Anyway, they're the best band. This is in your honour, Reginald.
Okay, thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you very
much. Goodbye,
brother. Peace. Well, I don't know about you, but that kind of made my year today, as a non in my sort of personal experience of individuals. I thought he was great. Reginald D Hunter, we were just talking about how smart he is, and actually, he's well been funny, what he was talking about intellectuals. I think he is deserving of our doctorate. He was the kind
we're
of,
all looking at Ellie, who's nodding and not getting anywhere close to the microphone.
I don't know whether, because you know something about about Reg. Go on.
Reginald's a genius. I mean, I knew him when he was starting out. God, must be nearly 20 years ago. Yeah. And an absolutely amazing guy who's gone from playing the club circuit, small clubs, right up to the top. Yeah, I agree with you. I think, honorary doctorate, we have visiting professors like Chris Packham and Jason Bradbury, and he'd be a great addition. I mean, if you're going to study, you want to study from someone who's really done it.
Apart from anything else, I want to just go basically for a beer with him, which is an odd thing to say.
What was his expression? Blow the froth off?
Blow the frost off. I think it was something like blow the frost off. Yeah. And Lord bro. It's like, he's just fantastic, you know? But maybe all my guests could come out for it. We could sort of do a bit of a... But I shouldn't really talk. I've just got to remind you that in my day job, I do run one of the largest substance misuse services in the country. So maybe it'll be a glass of water or something. But we've had three excellent guests. They've just been superb. Mm. And then you've had me wittering on about stuff.
But let's make you blush again. Well, do you remember what Angela was saying? And this is what she comes and talks to our journalism students and media. It's about listening.
Yeah.
And you're a great listener.
Am I?
Yeah. Because once you've got over the excitement of having
Reginald
D.
Hunter. My sitting there going, no, he ain't. Yeah. No, he ain't.
Well, no, I'm talking about on the radio. And you just kept going, and they were responding to you. And that is the art of radio. This is why I'll have him back again.
That's the trick. I thought it was about just kind of, I don't know. Well, they had interesting things to say, which is the thing, really.
But they also know who they're talking to. And I don't underestimate the chemistry that happens there. You know, it's the Parkinson thing, isn't it?
Yeah, you know. Me and Parkinson.
I think you could be Parky.
I think
I could be Parky.
I think we have the new Parky.
I could be Parky.
Lord Bro. Can you imagine it?
The Lord Bro show.
Come on down and meet Lord Bro here on Siren 107.3 FM.
The first person I'd have on is Parky. Can you imagine it?
Two Yorkshiremen. Why would he refuse?
Well, actually, that's interesting.
Next time you're back.
I met Jeff Boycott once in the Eagle Press.
And you don't know anything about cricket?
And I don't know anything about cricket, actually. I've got to be honest, I didn't know anything about cricket. And he was quite, well, he's the kind of, because Yorkshire people are supposed to be really sort of brusque. And he was. He was. Now, if you're listening out there, you were quite rude. But he's supposed to be, it was the Eagle Press. And he was incredibly, he was kind of scary in a way. Put me off cricket for life. You are supposed to, if you're from Yorkshire, be into two things, rugby or cricket, and I'm not into either. Mm-hmm. So I've kind of lost. The football doesn't do it for me either. So I've got nothing to talk to men about, really. Absolutely.
So which part of Yorkshire are you from?
Wakefield.
Ah.
Yeah, God's own country.
Absolutely.
Have you been there?
Yeah. My wife's a Yorkshire lady.
Is she?
Oh, yes. Yeah, she's a Leeds lass.
Oh, right. I knew there was a glow of excellence about you. Every time we meet, I knew there was a halo of something good.
We have a huge number of great students.
And
Lee Milner, who works at BBC Radio Lincolnshire, she used to say she was from Shaky Wakey. That's what she used to say.
Well, the thing about Wakefield, you need to know. So Wakefield is, it has, at one point, I don't know if it still has, but it has more pubs per capita than any other city in the country. Whether that's still the case, it certainly did when I lived there. And we used to do something. This is terrible, and I really don't ever do this at home. And it's a shocking thing to admit. And people stopped doing it now. There was the Westgate Run, and you would start at the bottom of Westgate, which was a hill, in a pub called the Redout, and you'd have a half, and you would have a half in every pub till you got to the top. And if you were still standing, you were a man, my son. And that's a terrible game. You think about it. I was talking to somebody about it the other day, my mate Mike, who may well be listening, and we were saying, what a crazy stunt. We used to do, that was a regular thing, that was a rite of passage. And now, when I go to Wakefield, as I do many towns like Wakefield, one of the things that makes me sad, actually, is if you go on a Thursday night or a Friday night, people have started drinking at 3:30. I don't know whether it's an issue in Lincoln, I really don't know, but you know, by sort of 7 o'clock, people are absolutely, you know, and then they're going out for another drink, you know, and as my mother used to say, you know, they're sort of the half dressed, you know, which is a terrible, terrible thing, you know, and then of course there's the men who would come out in their sort of, you know, and it, the police who I worry about. Anyway, enough. I'm not really, you know, I'm not anti-drink. I just think
in moderation.
You know what? It's a social thing. But it's become something else. And what I've noticed, and it is true, that women, young women, and it started in the 90s with the Ladette culture. And I don't know whether Zoe Ball's ever said anything about this, because there were sort of some women that were the head of this thing. And it was all about women getting as drunk as men and behaving as badly. And of course, women, it's just a physiological fact, cannot. And I know women who damaged themselves, you know, really badly because they were trying to do this Ladette thing. And I just think that actually the people, and of course the people who started it, quite wealthy and could afford to get themselves treated in nice places in California, and they've come out now. And they're doing fine. Everyone else is terrible.
Excuse me. I was fascinating when you were talking to... Yeah, I know.
Stop drinking.
I'd like to start. but not this time of the afternoon.
3 o'clock.
I know. Gone are the days that we used to, working at Radio Nottingham, we'd go out at 1 o'clock after the 1 o'clock news bulletin, and by the time the newsboys had got back at 3 o'clock, they couldn't read a word to save their life.
I used to have
to do all the afternoon bulletins. Anyway, before I besmirch all my old friends from BBC Radio Nottingham days, you were talking about what would it be like for you and Reginald D to walk down a street,
street
in Tennessee?
Alabama.
I was
Tennessee.
Trying to work out in
Scary,
your head.
I think is the answer. Mm.
Because he do a series when he went to the Deep South, didn't he?
He did a series on blues music, actually, which is worth watching. And he actually shows his deep knowledge of the South. and of blues music, and it shows him going round the South. I don't know. I think most fears are imagined. I suspect that if I went to the South, it'd be fine. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It'd be fine. And I was ranting on about drink, but there's one more thing I wanted to say about drink, which I find interesting, which is there were times when I was raising money in the city, and people would start drinking. They'd go for lunch, you know, and they wouldn't finish till 3. And people would roll out of these events, and they'd go, and you'd ask them, you know, what do they do? Because I was like, I didn't drink, because I had to go back to work, you know, basically. And you'd say, well, so what are you going to go back to do? And they'd say, well, you know, I'm a fund manager. And the horrible thing about it is, when I talk to some of the people in our services, and you say, so what do you want to be, or what do you want to do? And they say, well, you know, I'm a heroin addict, or I'm an alcoholic, or whatever. And you say, well, that's not a job, that's a condition. And the difference between professional addiction, if you see what I mean, and just poor working class ordinary addiction is massive. You become the thing you're addicted to if you're working class. But if you're a professional or middle class, you can go home, drink a couple of bottles of wine, get up the next morning, you know, run a fund. And you probably can't do that now, but people didn't associate the drinking with their profession. I'm more interested in what people can do as opposed to what they can't. Anyway, rant over. Enough talking about addiction. There are happier things in life, I guess.
We've got one more of your special tracks, and then we're going to play a couple more tracks. Marvin Gaye?
Well, yeah, I picked this because there is a thing about politics. There's a lot going on at the moment, isn't there? It's not just the election and what's happened in 2015. There's just a sense that we're still... There's a feeling of deja vu I have. I don't know about you. I'm looking around there's a feeling that we've been here before. Mm-hmm. It's not quite, you know, it's not quite the future yet or something. Mm-hmm. And I was trying to find from my thousands of songs something that kind of summarised my view of this. And up came Marvin Gaye, who of course is sadly no longer with us. But he's just, I don't know. And I play this. You tell me whether, I mean, this is a very old track. But think about it, and I think if this came out yesterday, it would still be dead relevant. So let's hear some Marvin Gaye, because he's just cool. So I've got to, there's some things I need to do. I mean, Reginald D Hunter, I just think if you get a chance to see him in Lincoln, he's on the 18th of June, isn't he, coming over?
Yep.
Yes, doing some 18th, stuff on 18th of June.
I just think he'd be great. And we've just been talking about getting him in to do a masterclass and, you know, and
so
actually,
many ideas.
And actually getting him to talk somebody. Because I think he's got some, I want to be there for that. I think he'd just be great. And you've got, the place is going to be a wash. It's going to be a wash next week with ermine and people walking about, you know, Lincoln, who have got grand titles and grander houses. And Princess Anne is coming over, and Caroline Duffy is coming on Monday.
That's
won't be here for that, which is cool, I guess. Well, I'd like to. I've met Princess Anne once, actually. She came to something I did for the CAB, and remarkably knowledgeable, actually. Mm-hmm. Remarkably grounded individual.
Now, she knows about horses.
She does know about horses. She does know about horses. As does my good lady wife. I've got to say this on the radio, actually, because the first holiday we went on, so was, anyway, we ended up at this place that does horses, you know, and you go on these horse rides.
What, trekking?
Trekking, that's it. That's what it's
does
called.
Does horses.
Trekking, yeah, does horses. Yeah, I don't do horses. And they bring out these two horses, and one of them is like the equine equivalent of a Ferrari. It's like jumping up and down, you know, revving to go. And that's the one that T picks, right? And I picked the one that's the, you know, yeah, Dobbin, the mule for me. But it was kind of a fairly big horse. So I get on this horse, and this is absolutely true. And I'm nervous, and the horse can tell I'm nervous. Mm-hmm. And this is the thing that is guaranteed to shrink any man to the size of a pea, right? Was when your wife-to-be turns to you, when you're nervous, and you can tell they're nervous, and you're pretending to be a man, and your wife says, be alpha, right? Which is like, control the horse, you know, and I'm thinking the horse is going to control me. And as we were going through, just to top it up, as we were going through the bush, this bullock comes out, and the horse, my horse, rears up. And of course, at that point, I've lost all control. I'm grabbing the horse's neck. It's always a good idea to sit in the same direction as the horse. And I was sitting there. And I have to admit, in front of my good people in this studio, I screamed like a young girl. Yeah. It did scream like Inga. And the horse turned round and just headed back to the stables. It knew. You could see the horse. It kind of looked at me and thought, I'm going home. I've got nothing more. You're not going to ride me, mate. I'm riding you. And it just took me home. And I've never got over it, to be honest. It's not that I don't like horses. It's that horses don't like me. They look at me and they think, dreads, I'm not getting up. So, we are. We've got the Freedom Festival next week, which is a celebration of the Magna Carta, and you've got bands and all that coming on. If you've listened to this, you haven't been to Lincoln, you've got to come, actually, because it's a beautiful place. It has a waterfront, and there are yachts and boats and things. And, of course, there's the cathedral, which is a stunning building. As you drive up to Lincoln, it rises. It literally rises out of the hills. And I think it was designed to do that. It was shock and awe. It was the equivalent of Cape Canaveral when it was built. It was one of these things that really does. And driving to Lincoln, it's kind of, you think it's going to be there. You're going to be all these signs. You don't see any signs for ages. And then you suddenly see this sign that says Lincoln. You think, crikey, it's not like going to York, where there are signs to York about 10 miles outside London. You know, it's like, drive to York. Lincoln hasn't got that, and then suddenly you see this cathedral rising over the hills, and you arrive, and you think, it's one of Britain's best kept secrets. Mm-hmm. Not anymore, but it's just such a beautiful place. And then you've got the university, which I'm so proud to be Chancellor of, because it contributes, I was told, something like 14% of the GDP in Lincolnshire comes from the university. So this is no joke, is it? This is like serious stuff.
Well, one of the biggest things that happened to Lincoln was the university, because it completely transformed eating. I should tell you why. Right, okay. 32
I'm drinking,
years ago,
probably.
Well, no. Well,
7,000 students.
32 odd years ago, they started BBC Radio Lincolnshire. My wife was part of the startup team. I also helped with the jingles, and I came across from Radio Nottingham.
Yeah,
and we were doing some clever stuff up the hill, up at, you know, where it is, up at the top of the hill. And I said, at 5 o'clock, I said, okay, then, so should we take a break and we'll go and have something to eat? And they looked at me and said, have something to eat? I said, we'll go and get some supper or something. Not in Lincoln. 5 o'clock in Lincoln, 35 years ago, you could not get a hot meal after 5 o'clock at night.
But things have changed a lot.
I'll say.
Things have changed dramatically. And it is because... And this area
you can't
here,
move for restaurants around
this
here.
Area was horrendous because it was the disused railway lines.
Yeah, well, I'd have to say that it's... I mean, I've seen pictures of the railway lines before you got all this. And, you wouldn't... It's not the place you'd walk at night, is it? But, I mean, now it's just...
Awesome.
It's got cinema, electric lights. It's got...
gas.
You know, it's gas. You know, there's pavements. It's fantastic. People
now that's
shoes.
Just wrong. We've it's got just, everything here.
It's got well, you had, talking of Top Gear, actually. Now, I don't think you made enough of this. Because Top Gear came to Lincoln, didn't they? To when they were celebrating...
Stole the university's electricity.
Yeah, they were taking the mickey out of the electric car and they came here. And Jeremy Clarkson wasn't rude or anything.
No, he loved us.
Well,
we've got the world's expert in sustainable power here, I think, haven't we?
Really?
Who created some of the...
Is it true? I don't know how true this is. So you have to tell me if it's not. But Lincoln University is also a world-renowned centre for equine studies. Is that right?
I was told it was one of the top...
And also studying animal behaviour with dogs and cats.
Yeah,
phenomenal.
I mean, we're number one for loads of things.
And the maths department has now attracted some really top-rank Russian mathematicians.
So if you want to get your pet on Britain's Got Talent, you've got to come here because we know.
What about that controversy, though? I mean, does it matter that she had three dogs?
Yeah, I think it matters a lot.
Do you?
Yeah, of course it matters.
But the magician must have had other people.
No, well, but he's a magician, isn't he? Everybody knows he's playing tricks. But you come on, you go on telly with a dog, right? So people are thinking, I bet most people thought that was one dog, not eight. It's like, come on, that's not right.
But I don't
that's
see
not
that.
Right. It wasn't even a dog, it was like someone else's dog.
But either way, it walked across a tightrope. I don't care which dog did it.
Spoke Shakespeare. She's the one that's going to make the money. The dog doesn't care. It's like, come on. The dog's not thinking, that's my pension. The dog's just going to think, she had 8 dogs. That's not right.
Okay, time out. Because I have a very important announcement, mate. We've got the final track in a minute. Don't go. And you've got to say goodbyes. But before that, we think, on behalf of Team Siren, there's Ed and there's JP, that you've done quite a good job this afternoon.
Oh,
so we would like to make you an honorary volunteer member of the staff.
Ooh.
And we've even got a little badge.
Oh, wow.
There you go.
Cool. Thank you very, very much.
I've not given you a swipe card to get in the door
yet. I'd be back all the time, actually.
Yeah.
I just think this is...
Sneaking in at the dead of night with Helena Kennedy.
Signed and everything.
Yep.
Wow.
So you now have the official...
I think that is fantastic.
I want you to promise to wear that at the next opening of Parliament underneath your ermine.
I'm wearing it. I promise you, I'll wear this to the House of Lords next time I go in. I'll have a photograph of me taken.
That would be terrific. And we could put it on our website.
I might wear it tonight, actually, come to think of it. I think that is fantastic. Well, it's been really kind of flown by.
It has.
I was really nervous to start with, and I was thinking this is going to be terribly embarrassing. No. And my wife's going to disown me, and she'll have to call me Smith and something. And it's turned out to be...
But it's Lord Bro.
Quite the giggle.
Anyway, can you introduce your final track?
Oh, yeah,
we've got the next team to get in. We've got the 3 co-producers.
Yeah, yeah. So, this isn't kind of mine, really, but it's on here.
It's sort of works.
It's fine. It's all right. I'm a big fan of Robert Palmer, who's no longer with us, and UB40. So thank you, everybody. You've been so cool. And thank you for listening. If you have been listening, if you've switched off, well, you know. It is Robert Palmer. I'll be your baby. Thanks. Bye-bye.